see that, and I had a, I know I didn't make it last week, because of, my wife gets scared, because I was snowing out once before, and she was left without power, without cell phone, without water, and all this stuff, so, now she's developed PTSD, and a trauma over there. But anyways, I've been watching the weather and stuff, and one thing about it, on Sundays, if ever decides I want to snow or something, we're just going to make our way down and get a hotel and come to church and stuff, because my situation will change eventually. Just believe God with us. Amen. You know. But I was, my kids had texted me, and then my daughter, which is my youngest daughter, she's the one that's not married. She called me this morning, or I mean this tonight actually, and something that she said that really blessed me. She's a school teacher at a private school, a Christian school, and she said, "Dad, you got me now, because I don't take anything less. The way you raised me." And I just appreciate it. I thank you for it. And you raised me to love God, to serve God. I know I could go into even a public school, even make more money, you know. But I just gotta say Jesus. I have to speak the name of Jesus, because that's the solution to the problems. Even teaching, she gets a lot of. What do you call it? Credibility from the parents, you know, that she's good. She really believes in her teaching, but she teaches them Jesus, you know. And she does, and she gets together a lot of some plays that they do for the school. They use her in that, but it just almost brought me to tears to hear that. And she says, "Dad, I just want to thank you for being that example and for." Putting that in me, and
as a result, I serve God.
I serve God. Praise the Lord. Amen. And of course, my other daughter that had gone off and got addicted to some stuff, and then my older daughter, and then she had an encounter with God, and she just gave her whole life there, coming around. One thing about preacher's kids, they get a shoulder and a stick oftentimes. Because there's an expectancy that's placed on them. You're a preacher's kids, and you got to act a certain way, almost like taking away who they are as kids. And then during that time, we were raising our first two kids. The third one was a surprise. It was a pleasant surprise. And we got these two kids, our two kids, and they were they suffered a lot of the pressure. They saw a lot of chunk that goes on with sometimes behind the scenes with ministry and people, how they act, how they maybe treat a pastor, and they talk behind the back, or they gossip, and they say all this, and some of this stuff just fell. My kids experienced all that stuff, and so it took them a while for them to come around. My son hasn't quite gotten there or back. But my daughter is there. Both my daughters are there. And I thank God for them. And I look back, and one thing about it is that you can't have regrets. Those parents, you have kids. If you could do it again, you know, you would do it differently. How many would say things like that? Yeah. If you had life to live over again, you would make the choices that you've made. You know, we have certain, you know, regrets and stuff. Just look, and I say, if I had raised my other two kids the way I raised my last one, I think it would have turned out differently. They would not have had to go through what they went through. And one thing about it is that we were like workaholics, and you could get so busy doing the thing, the work of the ministry, and you lose sight of your own family, and it bit us. And so I thank God for forgiveness. I thank God we get to do it over. And that's why we had a surprise baby. I think 7 years later, we had a I surprised baby. I was there in the hospital room, and my wife was giving forth the birth, and they put her in my arms, and I just looked, and I just began to cry, because I said, God, you give me another chance. So I'm gonna just put so much into this one. I'm gonna put my time into it. I'm gonna put my love, but I'm gonna tell her she can do anything her heart's desire is that God puts before her. And
I changed the way
she thought different than the way I did with my other children. And also I know one thing is that the gospel is powerful. The word of God is powerful. You present that, I don't care if your kids are maybe already grown or something, you just go and just speak the word over them, because it's powerful.
Amen.
Powerful. Praise the Lord. In fact, I did stop having birthdays, so, you know, I'll just pick the lower of the years and pick anniversaries. Okay, we just have an anniversary. You have something to say? Well, I want to, let's over and turn to Romans chapter 8. I started something a couple weeks ago. It is being made alive in the Spirit. Let me say, I'm going to say this. When we get born again, we get born again of God's Spirit. And when God's Spirit comes into us, where does the Holy Spirit connect to? Who can tell me? Okay, the Holy Spirit into, what would you say? Correct. Correct. It connects to our spirit. But what was going on with our spirit before that? It was dead. It was dead to what? Okay, it was dead to God. And it all started with the Garden of Eden when Adam disobeyed God. And at that point, remember what God said? He says, the day that you disobey and you eat of the wrong tree, he says, you shall surely die. He said, the day that you eat, you shall die. And ever since then, man has experienced shame and guilt. Now, shame and guilt is attached to our flesh. It's attached to our bodies. So now, we are being driven. This is a Bible study now, so I'm going to break some stuff down. We are being driven ever since that time by the elements that are around us. We're subject to the elements of this age. We're subject to the negativity. We're subject to sicknesses of all kinds. We're subject to the diseases of all kinds. And they're finding out more and more different diseases that are coming up. And they're trying to find cure for them. Trying to find cures for cancers. And you know what the thing is that when we get born again, God gives us an opportunity to come out of those things. The only thing is that we always have a tendency to resurrect our bodies, to resurrect our flesh. Here's the resurrection of our flesh. The resurrection of our flesh is that we give heed to what we feel. We obey to what we feel, what we see, what we hear, we obey it. I'm upset with so-and-so. This happened in my life, or you know what? This person did this and made me go into a bad mood, or they may be angry and all. See, what you're doing is that you're being obedient to your flesh. You're giving in to your flesh. And here, what I'm going to teach you in a few moments is that the Bible teaches us, in fact, a lot of the epistles. Some of you have even gone into the Old Testament, read the histories and stuff. But and that's good. The thing is, we don't live in the Old Testament. We live in the New Testament. See, because in the Old Testament, it was a shadow of truth. There were things that were hidden. But when Jesus showed up, it is now revealed. The Holy Spirit concealed. I mean, the Old Testament was concealed of truth. Truth was concealed. Now, in the New Testament, it talks about that it was a mystery. But now, that mystery is still a mystery to Christians that don't seek. That don't seek for truth. When you get born again, it is our responsibility to seek. It's our responsibility to find out how to live. If you don't learn how to live as a Christian, you will revert back to how you've always lived. And then you become sense-driven. And when you're sense-driven and you tell other people that are not Christians, you tell them that you're a Christian and you're sense-driven, they don't see it. See, you're driven the way they're driven. So there's no difference between a Christian and a non-Christian. That's the reason why you don't see people just swarming at the doors just wanting to get into church, because they see a lot of Christians' lives that are not affected like their lives. But see, what happens is I see that over and over again, that Christians are affected in the same manner as sinners. And then you know what we do? Oh, wow, we're flat. Flesh. Flesh? Okay. Life is given to what? Where's life given? It comes from the Holy Spirit. Okay, it's given to the believer through
Jesus.
It is by faith, but it's given through the Spirit. What Spirit again? Okay, the Holy Spirit gives to what Spirit? Man's spirit. Okay. So now our responsibility is to feed our spirit. And what it feeds our spirit is God's word, because Jesus said, the words I speak unto you, they are spirit and a life. So we can never experience life until we have a spirit connection. God raised us up and he seated us with him. And what we have to do is make a choice every single day to remain seated there. To be seated means there's a place of rest. When you walk into a chaotic situation, you should be able to go in there with the peace of God and settle all down. Amen. Don't be a part of it. Well, I'm just all riled up over that. They got me all going and stuff. They didn't get you going. You got yourself. You just chose to obey your flesh. See, if we don't obey God, we're going to obey something. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Yeah. We have choices. We have choices to make. In fact, we have one of the major two choices that we have is faith and fear. Faith and fear. Now, what does fear do? Okay, what's operating? What is? It paralyzes, but what does it stop?
It stops
faith. Okay, now faith is the giver of the life. Faith is the ability. When we operate with faith and we feed our faith, it gives us a picture of heaven. How heaven wants us to live. How we've been designed to live. Remember, God, by the Holy Spirit, is getting us back and bringing restoration, because it's called the ministry of restoration. Yeah. Restoration and family fellowship. So it's a ministry of restoration. I teach a lot of that in that area. That's why we call it the church, that. Restoration. It is there to bring restoration back to what the enemy has stolen from us. But it just doesn't happen. We have to do something to feed our spirit so we know what has been restored in our lives. Praise the Lord. Look at this. Romans. Romans chapter 8, verse 11 says, "But if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you." Now look, but if the spirit of him, the spirit of God, okay? But if the spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, God who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit, God's spirit, who dwells in you. Now notice that word right here. The one, that same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, dwells in you. See that word dwell?
Lives.
See, that's the key right there. To dwell means to abide or to continue in it. You can't be a Christian one day and then live your own life the next day. It doesn't work. As a matter of fact, I see I've done that before years and years ago. That's a miserable life. It's a miserable life to get in, have one foot in the door, and the other foot doing your own thing. That is miserable. You will create a whole lot of problems in your life. You will create, nobody else, you will create it. Because the enemy is like a roaring lion. He is on the outside. We already know he's the prince of the power of the air. Now, the only way that the enemy can influence us is by way of our flesh. He can't get in. Why? Because greater is he that's in you than that which is roaming around like a lion. Okay, he can't get in. He wants to eventually reside back in. So if you keep messing up, and don't repent, eventually you're going to find yourself where the enemy takes possession of you again. The only thing is, you become seven times worse, according to what Jesus said. Okay? So you don't want to mess with that. You want to be able to be in a place where you're going to have repentance all the time, right at hand. So if you mess up, because God made a way for us to escape, and that is by way of repentance. Repentance means this: I acknowledge what I do wrong, and now I'm going to get off the path that where I was doing wrong, that created the consequences. Now I'm going to get on the path that I got off of, because the path that I was on was what gave me life and gave me victory and gave me an overcoming life where I can walk. I can walk in a place of stability. See, so now we can do that. Praise the Lord. We can do it over and over and over again. Now, the key is to dwell. That means this: I have to allow the Holy Spirit to lead me into truth. I have to allow him to. I have to give permission to him. Every single day, we are going to be challenged with our flesh in different situations that rise up. We're going to be challenged all the time, and we're going to be given a choice. If you get upset, now you have a choice. You have a choice. Are you going to stay upset, or are you going to get out of being upset? Well, I'm going to try to get out of being upset. Okay, if you're going to try to get out, you're going to fall into it. See, what you have to do is that I got to get out of it, and so I've got to replace it with something else that will keep me out of it. See, so what is it? What do I got to do if I'm upset with somebody? I need to do this. I need to whether repent or make it right with them, and if they don't want to get it right, just get it right anyways with yourself, and then go forward. Amen. And move on. Praise the Lord. See, that this is necessary for our life in order to live in resurrection. Because remember, resurrection means that we are to Because we have to experience a death to our bodies. We have to remind ourselves that our bodies are dead to what it wants to do. Whatever it feels like doing and all. I'm talking about even going and watching the wrong kind of programs on TV or getting on the wrong kind of site on the internet or something. Do whatever it takes. Get in the wrong kind of relationship. Get away from it. Because never be led, even in relationships, never be led by what you see. Oh, I like him. I like the way he looks. I like the way she looks. You know nothing about their brain. You know nothing what's in their heart at all. You're just being moved by what you see. And you know what? You're asking for problems. You're asking for trouble. Well, I like him. I've been a pastor a lot of years, and I would have those singles that would come in, and especially like a woman, a single woman, she'd come in and she'd bring a guy in to church. Well, he's coming to church, you know. And I said, I don't know about that guy. I'm not sure about that guy there. Because you can always see, they always put their foot up forward, that, you know, to try to bring that. Or to impress. And I always say this, just give it time. Because you can only put your best forward for a short time. But after a while, when they get under pressure and they act out and they get upset and they get angry or something, you pinpoint it, you saw that, now you're willing to put up with that. Oh, but I love you. You know, all this and that. It's all flesh. Has nothing to do with spirit. Have you ever consulted your spirit? Well, I believe God. And you convince yourself, flesh-wise. You convince yourself. You say, well, look at this, look at that. You know, if you see somebody that's stubborn, are you willing to put up with somebody that's going to be stubborn? See, don't go after what you see on the outside. Go after what comes out of the mouth. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. And then you give it time, and under pressure, you'll see the real true person come out. But you know the best thing to do? Best thing to do is to be led by the Spirit.
Yeah.
Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. God, I like that. I like this. Now, that's any buying things. Have you read, how many here are impulsive buyers? You see something, yeah, I need that. Oh, I would like that. So adults don't grow up. Because you know that's what kids are. Right? You see something, oh, I need that. Oh, I got it. Oh, Mom, Dad, I'll do anything. I'll clean my room. I'll do whatever. Call manipulation. And all that is just flesh, 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 flesh. But see, as adults, you see what happens. If you're impulsive, what you need to learn to do is give yourself a time. Give yourself a chance. If you have a deal, walk away from it and think about it. And you're going to find out, Holy Spirit rises up and begins to tell you. Because you know what? The things that God has given to us pertains to life and godliness. God wants to be a part of our lives in our decisions that we make in our lives. He wants to be a part because we can open up some things that we wish we had never opened up. And God wants us to help prevent those things from happening. That means this, that we're going to have to live a surrendered life for the rest of our lives and say this, not my will, but your will be done. Over and over again. The Holy Spirit, when it dwells, it's got to lead. It's got to lead. He's not there to take up space. He's not there to just put extra weight. He's there to lead us. But we have to give him the opportunity to lead us. We need to acknowledge the power of the Holy Spirit because he's the Spirit of truth. He will give us the truth. Our flesh will lie to us. It'll lie. Amen. Now notice, It says that he, the same Spirit raised Christ from the dead will also give life to our mortal bodies. Now, what takes care of our mortal bodies? We do. Okay. Now, this is what has to happen. Now, if you're experiencing sickness, disease, what needs to be fed? How about feeding it before it happens? We wait for things to happen in our lives, and then we go and we reach out, pray. Please pray for me. Come on. And now what's happening is become a prayer of desperation. But it's not a prayer of desperation of faith. It's a prayer of desperation of fear. Fear, you don't get anything from God. It's faith. That's the reason why. What is it? Hebrews 11:6.
For without faith,
it's impossible to please God. See, because God loves us. He loves us. You have kids. Some of you have kids, right? Don't you, what'd you say? You got plenty. Okay. There's really an earthly father that's balanced, okay, sound mind. He wants to give whatever he possibly can to the kids. My daughter, my kids, other older kids, they're taken care of, you know. My son has a business. My daughter has a husband that makes mega stuff and all this well taken care of. My daughter's not married. So, you know, it's like we want to do anything for her. I mean, it's like, wow, Dad, you know, I really would like to do this, or I would like to have. But you know what? She doesn't ask for things. She doesn't ask for money. She doesn't ask nothing. We just see a need. And then my wife, we talk about it. And then we say, we want to meet that need. And then she gets surprised because we meet that need. See, all we are is just we are observant of her needs. I thank God I don't have any kids that come to me and ask me for things. Ask me for this. Dad, could you do this? Could you buy us this? My kids don't even do that. All three of my kids don't do that. And the thing is, as a result, it's easier to give. Easier to give. I want to. Now, I'm an earthly father. I'm an earthly father. Now, I'm going to have a tendency, maybe probably not to, if they're scoundrels, you know, I mean, if they're really rebels and they're in all kinds of messes in their lives and stuff, I'm more likely probably not going to help them out. They're going to have to learn on their own. But I'm more apt to help them and do things for them and be there for them. And I, like my last daughter, I told her, I says, anytime you want me, but she asked me one time to go with her to a meeting down in L.A., traffic, oh my God. I mean, when I got there and got to the meeting, it was a meeting the same night, it was 2-3 meetings in there, and I mean, I was wiped out. I was so tired. I went to a hotel room, and it's like, wow. But then I turned to her, you know, and I told her, I said, Carrie, I said, I'll do anything for you, anything you want. I'm here for you. Now, that's earthly father. Earthly father. I look at that as my heavenly father, that God desires to give us all things. But not the things that come by way of our flesh. Because our flesh has a tendency to ask for things to consume it for our own gratification. So God more likely is not going to give us those things. All right? Now, with a relationship attached to it, and you're not asking for God for this, this, and that, all you're asking is this. God, I just want to spend time with you. I just want you. I just love you. Father, I just want to get to know you. I just want to experience your love. Father, I just appreciate you so much. So much. Now, him being the Heavenly Father, what do you think he's going to do? The desires. God sees our need, and God will meet those needs that we have. Praise the Lord. Praise God. If you could only understand, we have a Heavenly Father that is so obsessed. You get the word? So obsessed with you and I. So obsessed. He has you and I on his heart all the time. If the Bible says he knows the very hairs, he counts the hairs on your head. Don't you think that, hey, he knows every detail of our lives? Praise the Lord. See, so why not just give it all and trust the Holy Spirit that gives us life? Because anybody that is led by their flesh, they're living in death. They're living in death. How many want to live in death? And I wouldn't raise your hands. Okay, well then you're gonna have to do something about it. Because if you don't, you'll live in death. I say this. We do not have the right, even though we take the right, to go and pick the occupation that we want. Because this, God has predestined us before the foundation of the world. He's already pre-planned our lives. But how many know that God will let us choose whatever we want and won't even stop us?
Yes.
Right? Okay, he won't. What is so vital for us to do is to ask God,
what is it that you would have
me to do? What is it? What is it that you want? Like I said before, I never, ever would have picked what I picked of being a preacher. I never would have picked it. I'd rather just have business that I had and all that and just go out and just increase in it and stuff. You know, no. But I picked this. It was birthed out of relationship for God. Yeah. Birthed out of relationship. The thing is, I believe God even chose me because he knew that I have to go all the way. I don't go part way. See, I don't believe in going part way. Because I'm going all the way, I think any other way that's other than going all the way, you're living a boring life. I wouldn't want your life if you live that way. Of course, I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to those that are going to listen to the tape. Okay. It is. I can see people's lives. I'm a people watcher. I watch people. I can go in the public. I can go to the mall or something. My wife would be shopping or something, and I'm patient. I just sit there. You know, I don't like shopping, of course. I'm a man, but I like to go in and out. You know, she just looks around and stuff. But you know, I don't put pressure on her. I just say, just take your time. It's okay. You know, and I'm praying. I'm praying in the spirit. I'm talking to God, and then I look at people, and I feel sorry for people. I see the way they act, and I'm thinking, you don't even know what eternity is. Eternity. I says, eternity is a long time. I think of people that die, I wonder, how they live. And then I find out later, they didn't live good. And I said, you know what? Well, maybe there's a fraction of chance that just before they died, they acknowledged Jesus. A fraction, that's all God needs. There's a fraction. I'm so sorry, Lord. I acknowledge you, Jesus, as the Savior. That's all. And then go into eternity.
Right.
Now, we probably have a hard time to get somebody like, let's say, a serial killer or something. Kill all kinds of people. And then just right when they get ready to die, they accept Christ into their lives. People like, look at that. They say, that's not just. Oh, yeah? We may not have done what they did, but we've done some stuff. And God forgave us.
Yeah.
See? So if they barely make it and they escape fire, praise God. You'd be living right next door to an ex-serial killer. But you know what? That's the mercy of God. That's the mercy of God. You got the society that it gets hard against people like that. And say, wait a minute, we can't do that. Jesus died for the world. Then you get the other side. You get the other side. Oh, there's people, they're being good people. I mean, they're right, they're upstanding, good American citizens. They pay their taxes and all this stuff. And they had a good job. They were good father, good mother, good husband, good wife and all. And when they died and stuff, and they died without Jesus. And they get the funeral and they talk about all the good they did, which is true. It's all the good that they did. But the Bible says that all our good works, according to Jeremiah, I believe Jeremiah 17, that all our good works, the right, is like filthy rags. When it compares to the righteousness of God, our works can never match the righteousness of God. We don't do good works to be accepted of God. We do good works as a result of being accepted from God. Praise the Lord. So as your relationship grows, you want to serve God. You entrust God with your life. And you trust God when God says, no, not right now. Because watch this. I believe in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, it says that all the promises, say all.
All.
All the promises are this. And watch. All the promises of God are what? What do you think it means? It is.
Yes
and amen. All right. Yeah, but how come I asked God and I haven't got it yet? Yeah. You know what it is? You're not ready for it. Because God sees a bigger picture. And the bigger picture is this. I need to change that part of your heart. Because if I give you this, it's going to spoil you. Parents, you can learn that from your children. So I got to give it to you. You don't give. You don't hand your car keys to a five-year-old and say, oh, go ahead. It's yours. You're part of the family. You're in the family, you know. You don't do that. You don't do that. They earn it by being faithful, being responsible. God is the same way. God's not going to entrust. In fact, entrust his whole truth here. And entrust it with people that are not seeking him. Because you don't value it. See, we have to value the treasure. Looking at this word, we have to value that above everything in life. And when you value it, it will work for you.
Come on.
This word that you value will actually transform your heart. So if you want change in your life, value the word. Because the word gives us life. It brings life to our spirit. When it brings life to our spirit, it quickens our mortal flesh. To quicken means to give life to our flesh. So when you experience sickness, your spirit will take care of your flesh. It's an operation of our faith. You see, your body will say, well, I don't feel it. I still feel sick. No, flesh, shut up. You know, I'm not going to go by your senses. You always got me in trouble. I have to go by faith. Your flesh goes, what is that? Yeah, it is. Faith doesn't need the evidence of the sense realm.
Hallelujah.
It doesn't go by the sense realm. When is God going to do this? Well, if you operate in faith, you'll be able to see what he's doing. But if you live in the senses, you can't see what God's doing. That's why people will say, well, you never know what God's going to do. It's very mysterious. How can that be? That has nothing. It doesn't say that in Scripture, because you'll find it in Ephesians. There it talks about that he's revealed his mystery, the mystery of the gospel. He has revealed it unto his saints. Now notice, if we are saints, saints that have been called out and live and walk like they're called out. That means you can't be messing with your flesh. Praise the Lord. This mystery has been unfolded. I know more today than I did when I first got saved in 1971. I got saved in 1971. And I was so excited. But I am more excited about my salvation than I ever have been.
Amen.
And it keeps increasing more and more and more. The thing is, it's giving me a hunger that I want more. So what I do is I go after the more. Because God will only give you what you go after. And it's got to be consistent, because you may not get it right away. Because there's still some areas of our life that need to get out of the way that's blurring our vision. Our attitude gets in the way. If we have a negative attitude and that gets in the way, then God can't unfold that mystery to us. And the mystery that he unfolds is to get that attitude out of the way, and teaches us how to not get back into the attitude.
Right.
It teaches a new way of life, a new way of living. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
See, you don't have to try to make it work by trying to be a good husband, a good wife, a good mother, a good father, you know, a good worker. You don't have to work at it. It's really effortless when you seek God out. Because you know what? You ought to make it become this. You ought to make it become good. Whatever you ought to do, you'll become good. You know why? Because the Bible says, whatever you put your hands to do, you shall prosper. It says that. It will succeed. God wants success in every believer. He wants us to make it. How many here that have kids want your kids to fail? Yeah. You know what? A good parent doesn't want their kids to fail. They want them to make it. They want them to succeed all the way. Praise the Lord. Now, don't enable them and go in there and try to make it a success for them. Let them go to the hard school of hard knocks. Let them go to the hard knocks of life. Let them go through it. That's how you learned. Praise the Lord. Sometimes we got parents that just don't want them to fall. Oh, no, I can't let them fall. No, let them fall. Be there for them, but let them fall. They learn. See, God will see us, and if we fall, he picks us up. But the only thing is that he wants us to reach out. When Peter was going down into the water, Peter cried out to God, to Jesus, and immediately he raised him up. But the Bible says he didn't fall right away. It says he began to fall. He began to sink. And the only reason why is because he looked at the circumstances of life. He became negative instead of walking in faith, because faith was causing him to walk on the water. Thank God that when we walk in faith and also we allow a little doubt come in there and fear comes in there, then we start to realize that we're going down, then all we do is call out and say, God, help my unbelief. Just like the father that was crying out for his son, yeah, for his healing. Father, help, Jesus, help my unbelief. So what is that? You're being real. God, I'm not there yet. You know that I'm not there yet, but help me to get there. You know, some Christians will go, yes, amen. Some Christians will go there and they'll say, you know, oh, well, one day I'll get there. One day will never happen. Bible says today is the day of salvation. Today. You gotta work on what needs to be worked on. How many have said this where you go and say, well, you know, I know God's trying to work these things in my life, you know, and you know, I have a hard time trying to get through this because, you know, I've done this for so long. Well, when are you going to give it up? Giving it up means that you make a decision today to give it up and don't take it up again. Now, the next day comes up and you want to take it up again, you got to remind yourself you let it go yesterday. And then as time goes on, you have to remind yourself, you let it go last week. Praise the Lord. You have to. You don't have to remind God. God already knows your commitment, which you made. Now, he's walking along with us. That's the reason why he gave us the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is the helper to help us through those difficult times while we're learning how to walk with faith. Thank God he doesn't beat us down because we haven't got it yet. That's why the Bible says, and it's his character, that he's long-suffering, that he's merciful, he's gracious, his mercy endures forever. But the thing is, if he's been that way with us, we need to be that way with one another. Because we can get irritated with one another. I'm talking about the family of God. Brothers and sisters also, you know, siblings, they fight with one another and argue with one another. But it happens in the body of Christ too. We're brothers and sisters. And we sometimes don't get along with such and such. And sometimes their attitude and sometimes their negativity. And sometimes their the way they talk or their personality and stuff. You know, what we have to do is that we have to give them what? We give them the grace. We give them the mercy. We give them everything that God gives to us. And if we would only remind ourselves when you get irritated with somebody, just remind ourselves, God has gotten irritated with us, and he's put up with us, and he's put long suffering on us, so until we get it. Praise the Lord. Amen. Isn't that good stuff? See, that's the reason why I want to serve God, because he's helped me to become the man that I am today. I could never, if you told me I'd be what I am today as a husband, as a father, I would just say, God, so I know I want to be. See, I'd be in the yesterday. You know, I want to be, and we have good intentions. I do want to be. I just struggle. I struggle. The only reason why we struggle is because we're struggling to give it up. We're struggling to give it up. We've had it so long, it becomes our pet peeve. And we hold on to some of our character, of our stubbornness, and we're like caressing it. I've had it so long, you don't realize it. Even some of our issues that we get upset, we get angry, we're still holding on to anger issues, and we're just stroking it. I know I'm supposed to give this up. I know God don't like it, and I know my kids don't like it either, and I know that, and I'm stroking it. Sometimes we go and we massage it too. You know, yeah. And you know what? God lets us. He lets us. So a year from now, 2 years, 5 years from now, you'll still be doing it. I know I need to go to a program. I know I need to go to some classes and stuff like that. No, you need to stop being stubborn. And submit that part of your life. If you have a difficult time, submit it. You know, I mean, I had anger issues in my own personal self. Growing up as a kid, I was so frustrated. I was told that you don't know anything. Kids would be seen and not heard. So how do you express yourself? You just put it all in, stuff it all in. You get older, you don't know how to express it. And so instead, you express it through anger. You just get angry. You get frustrated, you get angry. Now, I could tolerate a lot. I'm an introvert, so I can tolerate a lot. The only thing is that once I tolerated, it became dangerous because then I would just blow up, destroy the house, destroy things, break things, and all that. And because I didn't know how to communicate. And then anything, and anyways, I thank God I'm not there anymore. Amen. And it feels good. Because like some of you, I stroked it. And I was a Christian. And I was spirit filled. And I spoke in tongues. And I wanted to be led of the Spirit. And I was led of the Spirit to only to a certain point. Because I still was stroking this over here. Mm-hmm. And that always created problems. The problems in the home. I put things like that. I know, and I'm sorry, but God, thank God for forgiveness. I put that on my son. My son ended up having that. He got frustrated. He went out there and just goes out there and starts creating havoc. Why? He was not allowed to express himself. So he goes and expresses himself out there in the street. You know? And so now they have a hard time trying to get rid of all that. And we need Jesus to get rid of it. The only thing is, when you get Jesus, you need to surrender. And you need to look at it and just retire in your stroking. Just give it up. Say, okay, that's it, Lord. Here, let me put it at the cross. Because you said you took care of it. And so I die to that. I die.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I think that you probably wouldn't really hear me if you had heard that I was really mean with my wife and started yelling at her and telling her this and that, you know. And somebody, if any of you found out and it came out like that, you would not want to hear me. But you know what? It doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. Not at all. And I says, you know what? I don't know if you had that class, I guess, with the couples, love and respect. That's the key. I love and respect. One thing that moved me the other night, in fact, last night, my wife was telling me, and I appreciate that. My wife is not real, what you call an emotional type person. Very seldom have I ever seen her cry, you know. But she said something to me that really, really made me feel good. And she goes, you know, I've been thinking about this, and I think about, you know, my sisters and my families and this and that. But you know what? I come to find out, and that's why I know God's talking to her. Glory. She said this. She goes, you really, after evaluating, you're really my best friend. You're really my best friend. I don't recall her ever saying that. But she said that. Don't tell her. Yeah. And she got, and I was like, you know, I wanted to go, yeah, I just. And he says, thank you, I appreciate it. And of course, vice versa. I said, "You're my friend too. If anything, that's the reason why I am that way. In case you want to know, Lorenzo, and some of the ones that are the staff and all. Sometimes they have a staff they had last year where they get away and they go out to the beach house and all, and they have meetings. And I said, I ain't going. I'd rather go with my wife, my best friend. And so, guess what? I will have a tablet, and I'll have FaceTime here, and we can have. I'll go into the meeting through the computer instead. I don't know. That's me. I'm not saying for everybody else. Okay, so don't call him on that, Jessica. But that's me. I just enjoy just being with my wife, rather than going anywhere else and stuff. But that's something that was created as time went on through the relationship. All this is being birthed. That's why I'm giving you key points. All of this is being birthed through relationship with God, because God is a lover. And when you allow that love, as was it Romans 5:5? It says that the love of God is poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. He gives it to my spirit. He transfers it to my soul. And then it hits my body, and then I feel it. Praise the Lord. And so what you do is you become an automatic lover. Do I have people that irritate me around? Does my wife still irritate me? Sure. But it doesn't upset the love. It doesn't shake the love. See, with people may upset and say, I get you frustrated at times. I said, man, it doesn't change the love. It's just that I can honestly say, yeah, but you know what? I love them. I love their stubborn self, but you know, I love them. I love their ignorant head, but I love them. We can have these things that go across our head, but you know what? Love will keep you connected. It'll keep you connected, and you keep getting fit. That's the reason why you become a lover. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.